welcome to Mariology. This is Dr. Mark Miravalle. My friends, throughout this course, we've been examining the truth about the mother of Jesus and our mother from scripture, from sacred tradition, as interpreted by the magisterium. The truth about Our Lady in terms of the dogmas and the fifth doctrine regarding her relationship with us. Also, theological reflection on who Our Lady is and why we should have a love for her, second only to the love properly given to the persons of the Trinity. For the Trinity, Latria, for Our Lady, what is called Hyperdulia. Then we talked about the modes of devotion to Our Lady, the Rosary, Marian consecration, scapular. And once again, theological reflections by the likes of St. John Paul II and St. Maximin Kolbe. Now, in our last lecture, we talked about the nature and purpose of Marian private revelation, its appropriate subordinate role to scripture and tradition, as interpreted by the magisterium, but also to have a proper appreciation for these celestial gifts when the Mother of God visits humanity in a very clear, concrete exercise of her doctrinal role as a mother to us in the order of grace, Lumen Gentium 61, as the mediatrix of each and every grace that comes from Jesus to us. Well, now we want to begin to discuss the Marian message to the modern world in terms of specific apparitions. And time certainly does not allow for an intensive and a comprehensive treatment of the Marian message to the modern world, which it certainly would merit its own course in itself. But I want to select some pillar apparitions that not only anticipate what is called the age of Mary, but then how that message from one mother admits of development, growth, and added specificity throughout the beginning of the 19th century through the 20th century and on into the 21st century. But before we get to the age of Mary, which incidentally, as we'll discuss in our next lecture, really begins with the Rue de Bach, Our Lady of Grace apparitions in 1830. Before that age of Mary begins formally, we have the great anticipation of the Marian message to the modern world as embodied in the historic apparitions of Our Lady of Guadalupe. So our historical setting, which is always important to understand why our mother comes and how she comes to a particular culture at a particular time. The historical background of 1531, the first apparition of Our Lady of Guadalupe, has on the European front the Protestant Reformation, which approximately in the 1530s through the first part of the 1540s would affect the loss of over 5 million Catholics from the Catholic Church. During this parallel time, through the intercession of Our Lady of Guadalupe, the Church would gain, in a comparable period, approximately between 8 and 9 million Catholics through the conversions that would come forward to what would become the greatest Catholic continent of all time, clearly on a quantitative basis, and that would be Latin America. And this is why, again, my friends, to reiterate a theme of our last lecture, there should be a gratitude. There should be not so much a sense of saying, well, technically we don't need Our Lady of Guadalupe. I'm not sure that would be a properly balanced Catholic approach. It certainly is not the approach that many a pope, saint, and mystic have taken. Rather, appreciation, gratitude, because through Our Lady of Guadalupe, the Catholic Church receives its most quantitative continental expression. And the love of the people of Latin America, and not exclusive to Latin America by any means, but in a particular way to Latin America, for Our Lady of Guadalupe is really a model for a proper Catholic devotion for Catholics throughout the world. So let's go to 1531. We have, first of all, the Protestant Reformation, which is taking place in Europe. We also have two modes of challenge for the indigenous people in the area of Mexico and beyond. The first challenge would be dimensions of the Aztec religion. As many of the commentary have pointed out, there were amidst the Aztec religion certainly elements that would represent diabolical dimensions. For example, what? Well, for example, some of the gods, the hummingbird wizard was one of the gods that was also known as the lover of hearts and the drinker of blood. The smoking mirror god that was known as the god of the demiurge and phantoms and monsters. Also, the principal mode of worship for the Aztec religion was human sacrifice, followed soon after by cannibalism. The near universal symbol of the Aztec religion was the serpent. So as commentators have mentioned, even from a historical perspective, there were certainly elements of deep challenge for the people from this seemingly diabolical dimension, at least in significant degree, of the Aztec religion. Now, another form of challenge on its own level, not the level of what we just discussed, would be forms, expressions of domination and unjust treatment by some of the Spanish conquistadors. Now, my friends, this should take nothing away from the nobility and the efficacy of, for example, the work of the Franciscans and the to-be Archbishop of Mexico City, Archbishop Zumarraga, who Charles V would declare as the protector of the people. And certainly the passing on of the Catholic faith that would show expressions of an evangelization remarkable. For example, St. Junipero Serra and the faith going up into California and beyond. So without taking away the authentic evangelical fruits of the conquest of and the missionary journey of Spain, there are also, tragically and sadly, cases of persecution, cases of pillage, cases of rape, cases of abuse among the Aztec peoples as well. And this leads us to one indication which is oftentimes present as to where Our Lady appears. It is often where her people are experiencing forms of oppression, where her children are in the greatest need. Is that not typical of motherhood? So, in ways similar to Our Lady appearing close to the garbage dump in Lourdes in terms of the apparitions to Saint Bernadette, or Our Lady's appearances in the church-approved apparitions of Kibeho, Rwanda, which was in anticipation and seeking the mitigation of a horrendous slaughter of close to 1 million people in 9 months, principally through the use of machete. That should not be something that draws us back in terms of saying, well, Our Lady wouldn't appear there because things were so difficult. The opposite indicator should be used. That oftentimes, Our Lady appears for her people in the greatest need. So within those contexts, let's now go to December 9th, 1531. The visionary is a man in his 50s. Juan Diego, now of course Saint Juan Diego, and he is on his way to hear Mass in the local town of Tlaclolo, for which he had a several mile jog to attend. And on the morning of December 9th, Juan Diego hears music, a type of heavenly music coming from Tepeyac Hill. Now, I want to provide for you at least one contemporary translation of what Our Lady says in her four principal apparitions in Guadalupe. And I do this for a couple reasons. First of all, because as close as we can get to the source within a good translation helps us to get the feel of the apparition. And by the feel of the apparition, I mean in a special way, the voice of the mother. Because we will see, as we're called to evaluate and examine later apparitions, that while there's diversity in accent, in message emphases, the voice of the mother remains. There's a certain peace, there's a peaceful urgency, there's a strength, but it's forever maternal. And so I'd like to read to you one contemporary translation of the words as recorded in the time soon after Juan Diego, within and soon after the time of Juan Diego. The original translation, because of its effort to be very literal, perhaps is great for scholarship but lacks a certain flow. I want to read to you a contemporary translation, which again seeks to be true to the message, but I think perhaps in this case is more fitting for an introductory level class, so you again get the feel and the flow of Our Lady's words. So this first apparition, again on December 9th, 1581, is recorded as follows. Our Lady, quote, Juanito, my son, where are you going? So the diminutive Juanito, of course, he's a man of 50, in his 50s, but everyone is a child in relation to Our Lady. Juanito, my son, where are you going? Juan Diego responds, noble lady, I am on my way to the church in Tlaclolo to hear Mass. Our Lady, know for certain, dearest of my sons, that I am the perfect and perpetual Virgin Mary, mother of the true God, through whom everything lives, the Lord of all things, who is mother of heaven and earth. I ardently desire a teokali, or a sanctuary, be built here for me, where I will show and offer all my love, my compassion, my help, and my protection to the people. I am your merciful mother, the mother of all who live united in this land and of all mankind, of all those who love me, of those who cry to me, of those who have confidence in me. Here I will hear their weeping and their sorrows, and will remedy and alleviate their sufferings, necessities, and misfortunes. Therefore, in order to realize my intentions, go to the house of the Bishop of Mexico City and tell him that I sent you and that it is my desire to have a teokali, once again, sanctuary or temple, can be translated either way, to be built here. Tell him all that you have seen and heard. Be assured that I shall be very grateful and will reward you for doing diligently what I have asked of you. Now that you have heard my words, my son, go and do everything as best as you can. Now, a few comments about this first apparition. So Our Lady will always have a title, which in a beautiful way summarizes, concretizes the major thrust of her message. At Guadalupe, it is as she just identified herself, quote, I am your merciful mother. That's the Guadalupe motto, the bumper sticker that summarizes the heart of this message. Notice, my friends, that Our Lady identifies herself. She manifests her love and compassion for the people, but then she asks for a church. Now, teokali can literally be translated temple or a place of sacrifice. And it's interesting that the original place of sacrifice that would become the first chapel was over a place of sacrifice to a mother goddess. So it's as if Our Lady is saying, do not sacrifice to this false mother goddess. I am the mother of the true deity, would be a literal translation. And so she wants the initiation of the sacrifice of the Mass to her true God, who is also her true son, and to the true deity for all. So this is a beautiful Catholic precedence. Instead of destroying, it's to build over in an appropriateness and in a rightness in terms of this. Notice also, Our Lady immediately calls for authority to the bishop. So we'll see this in every authentic apparition. A call to return to the prayer and sacramental life of the church, therefore the need for a church, A, and then B, respect for the local bishop and seeking, as amazing as it is, the mother of God and the mother of all peoples, but being respectful to the authority of the local bishop. Well, Juan Diego would go. He would go to Archbishop Zumarraga, a Franciscan archbishop, and understandably, the archbishop would not believe Juan Diego. Juan Diego would then go back, and the second apparition of Guadalupe, of the four major apparitions, what happened on that same day, December 9th, 1531. Essentially, Juan Diego would be saying, send someone else, I don't have the credibility. And this is how Our Lady responds to that response of Juan Diego, again, in this translation. Quote, listen to me, my dearest son, and understand that I have many servants and messengers whom I could charge with the delivery of my message. But it is altogether necessary that you should be the one to undertake this mission, and that it be through your mediation and assistance that my wish should be accomplished. I urge you to go to the bishop again tomorrow. Tell him in my name and make him fully understand my disposition, that he should undertake the erection of the teocalli for which I ask, and repeat to him that it is I in person, the ever Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, who sent you. A couple brief comments. Notice again that it's not based on global or secular credibility. It's based on God-given vocation. Our Lady has chosen Juan Diego, and she encourages him to follow through on this God-given mission. Our Lady repeats the identification of herself as the Virgin Mary, really the perfect and perpetual Virgin Mary. That's why, of course, many in Latin America will refer to Our Lady as La Virgen, because that's the one of the first identifications that she gives for herself. I also want to note that in context, in the larger context, these apparitions are happening during what was at that time a three-day celebration of the Immaculate Conception by the Franciscans. And so even the title Our Lady of Guadalupe has been the subject of some study, the likes of which we can't get into in full detail here. But essentially, Guadalupe was a Marian shrine back in Spain, and many thought it would be odd that she would refer to an apparition or a sanctuary back in Spain. But other linguistic studies show that the word Guadalupe sounds very similar to a word something like Guatzalup in the Nahuatl dialect. And many believe that that, properly translated, would translate as she who crushes the stone serpent. Now that's a fascinating idea, because the Aztec religion was certainly a religion of stone. There were large pyramids where sometimes on one occasion in the late 15th century, there were over 50,000 people executed within a period of 3 days, and the ritual priest would take out the still throbbing heart within a period of 30 to 45 seconds. So the stone pyramids represented a manifestation of this horrendous practice. So the possible translation in the Nahuatl, the native language of the Indians, could have been, according to some recent scholarship, she who crushes the stone serpent, which would fit well into the feast of the Immaculate Conception with Genesis 3:15, with Mary crushing the head of the serpent. Let's go on to the next day. So Sunday, December 10th, 1531, Juan Diego returns to Archbishop Zumarraga, and the Archbishop asks for a definitive sign that this is in fact Our Lady. So the third apparition is upon Juan Diego's return after this request from the Archbishop, and Juan Diego relays this request to Our Lady, and Our Lady tells him that he's to return the next day, which would have been December 11th, and the sign would be granted. Well, what happens on December 11th? On December 11th, Juan Diego's uncle, Juan Bernardino, becomes gravely ill, and instead of doing Our Lady's bidding, he tends to his potentially dying uncle. And so December 11th is not the day where, indeed, the message is conveyed to the bishop. On the morning of December 12th, Juan Bernardino is growing very close to death, and Juan Diego seeks to fetch the priest from Tlaclalo to have Juan Bernardino's confession heard. And out of a type of embarrassment or avoidance of Our Lady, realizing he had not done her bidding, he took a back route away from Tepeyac Hill, and Our Lady, in fact, intercepts him at the pass of this back route and essentially asks him, "Where are you going?" Juan Diego responds about his uncle, and then we have this message. Quote, "Listen and let it penetrate your heart, my dear little son. Do not be troubled or weighed down with grief. Do not fear any illness or vexation, anxiety or pain. Am I not here who am your mother? Are you not under my shadow and protection? Are you not in the folds of my mantle, in the crossing of my arms? Is there anything else you need? Do not let the illness of your uncle worry you, because he is not going to die of his sickness. At this very moment, he is cured." Now, that's an edited version of a longer message from Our Lady to Juan Diego. But it concludes, or it contains within itself, an instruction to pick the roses, to go up on the hill and pick the roses. And Juan Diego finds, in what is already a first miracle, Castilian roses, which were not native to that region, growing in the midst of a frozen December soil. Juan Diego picks the roses, and then in another constantly beautiful manifestation of our mother's total motherhood and femininity, she arranges the roses, and they are then tied in the back of Juan Diego's tilma, or cloak. Juan Diego goes, he presents the roses, and as the roses fall out, you have, of course, the classic supernatural image of Our Lady of Guadalupe, which is embedded in the tilma of Juan Diego's cloak. The bishop, the archbishop, would keep it in his private chapel, and then on December 26th of 1531, he would have a procession and bring it to a small makeshift chapel on Tepeyac, close to Tepeyac Hill, which would then begin the process of the world, well, really the continent-wide, and then later the worldwide devotion and promulgation of this devotion. Soon after the image was placed in that makeshift chapel, there was a miracle by a Indian who had been wounded in the neck by an arrow in some type of demonstration of martial arts, of their, you know, domestic martial arts. And immediately the miracle again would be a confirmation of the authenticity. Now, once again, within the next 8 to 9 years, there'd be between 7 and 8 million Catholics that would convert, and then it would extend exponentially throughout the whole region, the country to be, the continent, and then internationally. It's also fascinating that in the Battle of Lepanto in 1569 on October 7th, that Don Juan would have an image of Our Lady of Guadalupe on his ship as he sailed to defend Christendom and the church against the invading Muslim Turk naval fleet, much larger than his own. So already by that time, the image of Our Lady of Guadalupe takes on an international importance. Well, it's difficult to synthesize all the fruits that would come forward from the miracle of the image. I do want to make reference to a scientific study that was done with the permission of Cardinal Coripio Umada, who allowed a biochemist team, a scientific team from the University of Florida, to examine the tilma. I just want to mention a few of the findings from a perspective of science. Once again, I'm disclaiming any justice to the ubiquitous miraculous nature of the Choma. There's some outstanding books that deal specifically with the scientific conclusions of the Choma. Everything, as I'll mention briefly, from the images of Juan Diego and the bishop and perhaps the translator in the right eye of the image, to the fact that the overall Choma is like a topographical map of Mexico, as well as the fact as the constellation, if you will, of stars on the Choma corresponds perfectly with the constellation of December 12, 1531. My friends, the list goes on and on and on, mindful of Pascal's comment that it's irrational not to believe in the miraculous, including the miraculous as we see in Our Lady of Guadalupe. So just a few conclusions from Dr. Callahan from the University of Florida. Number one, there's an inexplicable brightness on the Choma in terms of its color, keeping in mind that over 400 years there's no fading indicative, but also that even the Choma itself, made out of a type of cactus foundation, would only have a life of 20 years at the most, let alone something past 400 years. Fascinatingly, in terms of pigment and the image, microscopic examination of the image shows that there are no brush marks on the Choma. Well, that leaves you with two possibilities scientifically. One is a 16th century laser printer that just, you know, pronounced the image on there, which of course did not exist, or a miracle, because there's no brush strokes on the image at all. There's also a few medical studies which seem to indicate that an extremely careful microscopic examination shows that the image actually hovers over, above, if you will, the Choma, that in the smallest of microscopic measurements, it's not that the colors are embedded into the cactus, it's as if it hovers over them in kind of a perpetual miracle. Once again, the conclusions of science. I want to point out just very briefly, again, the miracle that's found with an optical examination by an ophthalmologist of the pupil of the eyes. So in the right eye, a massive microscopic close-up would show three primary human figures with several human figures behind the three. And two of the three clearly represent Juan Diego, of whom there are portraits of, as well as Archbishop Zumarraga. The third person is perhaps the translator, since the Archbishop Zumarraga did not know the native dialect of the Natual. And so the idea that a forger back in the 16th century could paint that which even basic microscopic use could not bring forward, again, points to the supernatural. It's something simply beyond. Well, again, there's many, many miraculous elements of the Choma. I also want to make reference to in 1921, there was an effort to destroy the Choma through a bomb, and there was a massive metal crucifix that was very close to the Choma. The crucifix remains in the major basilica today. It was distorted and twisted because of the power of the bomb, and the Choma was left completely protected. Again, an indication of supernatural favor and supernatural intercession. Well, finally, Our Lady of Guadalupe is also the mother, the patroness of the unborn. Why? Because she's a pregnant Madonna, one of the very few pregnant Madonnas, and certainly the only supernatural image of a pregnant Madonna. And that's because the tie in the culture is high over the abdomen, which would indicate pregnancy. There are a series of miracles which have been lodged into the archives of Mexico City of people visiting not only the main image, but also pilgrim images of Our Lady of Guadalupe, where hundreds have testified to hearing two heartbeats. One heartbeat would be softer and faster. The second heartbeat would be louder and slower. And medical examinations of even the testimonies would indicate, well, that would be true of an unborn baby with a faster heartbeat, softer, and of a parent, in this case, obviously a mother, with a slower heartbeat. Our Lady of Guadalupe has gone all over the world in terms of the key and critical need to protect our unborn brothers and sisters in the womb. In many places where there are unfortunate legal efforts to legitimize the direct killing of an innocent human being in the womb, oftentimes pilgrim images of Our Lady of Guadalupe are brought to that land. So it can rightly be said that a continent is brought to Jesus through Our Lady's direct intercession, and that would be, in general, the continent of Latin America. Once again, the most populous Catholic continent in the world. Clearly, Our Lady of Guadalupe's influence and devotion is truly universal, once again leading back to her divine Son, our Lord Jesus. Well, thank you for being with us in today's lecture of Mariology. Praying you all God's blessing. This is Dr. Mark Miravalle wishing you and encouraging you to receive the great gift of Jesus to all of us personally from the cross to behold our mother. God bless you all.